we will kick off our panel discussion, and I will invite to the stage President, Strategic Advisor to the President of CIMC, Ms. Zheng Xianling. May I invite you to come onto the stage? And our panelists are Professor Chai Maorong, Chief Technical Officer of SPIC Hydrogen Energy Technology, Wu Zeling from De Nora, and Wu Yiwei from Baowu Clean Energy Corporation, Frank Ni, Principal Market Development at PGM China at Anglo America. May I invite all of our panelists to come onto the stage? Many thanks to the audience for staying with us. I'm still seeing a full house, so I just want to say special thanks. Now we are in the last panel discussion of today's session. My name is Zheng Xianling from CIMC. For the panel discussion, I'm seeing an interesting line of panelists. We have four panelists with us on stage, five panelists on stage with me. I'm from a company working on hydrogen storage and transportation, a leading player globally, my company, CIMC. We also have experts from companies focusing on different fields, from PEM to fuel cell to smelting, and from Anglo America. So it is fair to say that the experts and the panelists represent the complete picture of the hydrogen supply chain, the hydrogen chain in general. I'll start by asking all the panelists give us a short introduction of your company. I think such introduction serves several purposes. On the one hand, people all talk about hydrogen, the grand landscape and the great prospect. However, at the macro level, practical wise, we have a lot of problems. So at what stage hydrogen is, and what have we done? What can we do? I think personally, from the proposal of hydrogen economy, of the term hydrogen economy, 50 plus years have passed. And in 1990s, the professor who coined the item, the term hydrogen economy, published a book. So I think from 1960s to 1990s, we saw the first wave of hydrogen, and the second wave started in the 1990s as represented by GE, Ford, and the three auto giants in Europe, Benz, Audi, and BMW, as well as Toyota and Hyundai, entering the field of vehicle and OEM manufacturing. The third wave started in 2014, represented by the launch of Mirai by Toyota. It shows that OEMs from America and European Union temporarily exited the fuel cell passenger vehicle market, but European companies have stayed. So Professor Chai talked about hydrogen and the fuel cell. They actually represent two separate pathways. For one thing, fuel cell and hydrogen's utilization in fuel cell, actually producing, when producing fuel cell, hydrogen comes from various sources. It's just that we happen to have the synergy of hydrogen contributing to sustainability, and we need sustainability for the commercialization and industrial scale production of hydrogen. I think there are three keywords: scale, security, and sustainability. All three conditions have been met over the past decade. So my point is that today we see grand topics at the macro level and difficulties at the micro level. However, with the industry chain becoming more streamlined, all these things or all these difficulties are gonna be sorted out smoother. I think Professor Kang from Hainan University, you have studied catalysts for a long time, and now you are doing research on PEM and PEM catalysts for PAM and alkaline, actually PAM and alkaline electrolytes represent two different pathways. People used to say that in Europe saw a fast development of PAM, and the same can be said in the United States. But China, the dominant pathway is alkaline. However, things have changed. So may you walk us through your understanding of PAM electrolytes, thus using PAM to produce hydrogen, and give us a few words about your company. Main thanks to the moderator for the introduction. Maybe I can start with PAM. I heard from previous speakers saying that PAM and AEM are different. Actually, one of the biggest advantages of PAM is that it has very high current, working current density. In other words, it can work and produce hydrogen under a very high pressure. In other words, its efficiency of producing hydrogen and energy density is very high. And second is that it's highly adaptable compared with AEM or the cathode exchange membrane. PAM is very adaptable to the intermittency and the peak and low of electricity. So PAM is very optimal for the production of green hydrogen. So nowadays we say that the best way of producing green hydrogen is to use PAM, because for AEM and for other technology pathways, like, they are not as optimal as PAM. So PAM, in the best case scenario, is best combined with renewable energy. I think my research focus is in the multiple transport layer, the dispersion layer, as well as membrane electrode, some of the key components in all of these areas. And Professor Zhou, he talked about his research focus starting with materials, working on improving the conductivity, activity, and stability of the materials. In other words, his research focuses on improving the properties of the materials from the three perspectives. However, the materials themselves cannot be directly applied to PAM water electrolysis, because you only work on optimization of the materials. With optimized materials in place, the next step is to test the catalyst and catalyst materials, whether they can be applied to the components of the membrane electrode, because application or testing when materials are embedded in the membrane electrode is closer to the actual real-world scenario. So when the materials are developed, usually they are integrated with membrane electrodes, and testing is done on the membrane electrode in order to test the properties, including stability of these materials. That's one of my research focus. Another focus of my research is about the transport layer, because the membrane electrode is very close to the dispersion or the multiple layer, which is a very critical component. Why do I say that? When you have a membrane electrode with good stability and homogeneity, however, when the transport layer is not of good properties, then the PAM system will be affected. In other words, the performance of the system will drop significantly, or its life will fall far short of its expected life or intended life. So for cathode, you know, it has high potential with water and oxygen. A lot of materials are not practical in such an environment.
So we mostly use titanium-based material to make the porous layers. One is a titanium felt, as we saw before, and another one is kind of a sintered plate based on titanium. So one advantage of using this layer is that the technology is very mature, because the same thing was used in the screening board in other applications. So in other words, the sintered plate and the titanium felt can be taken from the shelf and use it in our modules, and also have a good performance and have a good durability and life. But the disadvantage is the permeability is not able to be controlled because it is a 3D, it's a random 3D structure. For example, the felt, it is made from the very complex fibers, and you're not able to control the pores. The sinister plate, it is also made out of the titanium particles, tiny particles. So the internal structure is very complex, and the pathways is very difficult to control. So what we do with Mr. Zhou is we produce the straight pore layer, the super thin straight pore layer. One biggest feature is that we can totally control the pores. It's a straight pore. So in other words, it can improve the efficiency of the water and the gas transmission. The water can get through this layer and get to the catalyst layer. And another advantage is it can reduce the resistance of the structure. In other words, it improved the conductivity. Well, with the felt and the sinister board, the electric resistance is very high, but with the straight pores, then since it is an homogeneous structure, so there is no internal obstacles inside those layers, so that would lead to low electric resistance. Another advantage is that the interface is a flat interface. If it is a sinister plate or a felt, then the contact is mostly point-to-point contact or the linear contact. With the straight pore solution, it can, because it has a flat interface or an area interface, we can reduce the contact resistance, we can improve the conductivity, we can also improve the performance of the memory electrode. So after testing, we found the efficiency can be improved by over 5% using the same catalyst. So simply replacing the porous layer, we can improve the efficiency by 5%. Now our research is focusing on the memory electrode, the catalyst, the making of the electrode. Well, there are many ways to make the electrode. Now mostly we use the way of coating, but if it is used in the mass production, they use a slit coating. With different approaches or different processes, it would also affect the performance and efficiency of the structure. Okay, and I'll end here. Well, we can see this is a super technical. He is indeed a scientist. Well, I used to be a mechanical engineer. In the mechanical engineering industry, I really see a disruptive innovation. But later, I went to the fuel cell industries and the hydrogen industry. I really regretted that I chose mechanical engineering at school. I'm very excited to hear from all these technology breakthroughs. You mentioned the straight pore layer, and it's very exciting. And I can see there are some other innovation in the electrolyzer. Alkaline electrolyzer. So we are very honored to have Jeff Wu, and your company is working in the electrolyzer and making innovations in this regard. Let's hear from you. Well, our company, the Nora Electrodi, is an Italian company. So the active anode and active cathode used in electrolyzer are already mature technology. So if you have heard the Saudi Arabia green hydrogen project, you would know that I want to tell you that the anode and cathode technology comes from us. Well, in the traditional technology, the voltage of the active cathode is 280 milliampere, and ours we can reduce this ampere by 100. So on one hand, it reduces the energy consumption; on the other hand, it improves the efficiency. So with our technology, companies like ThyssenKrupp and McPhy, their working current density can be over 8,000 ampere per square centimeters, and the highest can be 12,000. With such a high working current density, it can ensure high energy efficiency at the same time. We can also see that some domestic company are also looking at this solution, namely improve the working current density. I believe this is conducive to the healthy development of hydrogen economy. With more investment, with more talents in this regard, we believe that domestic technology can totally catch up with the leading technologies globally. And on the other hand, we still think there are room for improvement in terms of the cost. In our company, we are making efforts in this regard as well. At the mass production scenario, we developed the new precious metal coating. So compared with the traditional coating, is more stable. It is able to cope with the fluctuation and the frequent start and stop of the system. Well, thank you very much, Mr. Wu. As he said, a lot of investment and a lot of talents are flooding into this industry. In 2021, the electrolyzer production was only 400 megawatt, but we predict that by 2040, according to the presentation, and it can grow to 200 megawatt. But now I see a single project in Europe can have a capacity of 20 megawatt. So when the loop is not connected in the value chain, our estimations are overestimate. But whenever this total loop is closed, then and when all the technologies are ready, then the potential of the industry will totally exceed our expectation. So today, we are talking exactly that, how to break down the obstacles, how to make technology breakthroughs and close the loop of the value chain. Okay, so I'll tell you a story, actually. Last year, when I was talking about a passenger vehicle, some NEV players put me in the blacklist. But now, again, I'm advocating the fuel cells again, and I got many supporters and more supporters compared with last year. So every year when I work with Mr. Chai to give the talks or lectures, what I can feel is Mr. Chai really see everything through, can find the core of every issue in terms of the automotive industry. And Mr. Chai, you must have worked a lot in developing hydrogen technology in automotive industry. So what is the latest development? Can you share with us? Well, as said in my presentation, to develop hydrogen power in China, we need to sort out a few things. First of all, hydrogen power cannot only be used in automotive, it can be used in many different areas. So the biggest problem we have is whenever we talk about hydrogen, we think automotive only. We associate it with transportation, especially heavy-duty tractors. This is a misunderstanding. I have emphasized it many times. Every technology they have to develop from small to big. It's not like we're shooting for the moon overnight. Now we are only at a very low level of the hydrogen development. We're not able to achieve a megawatts level or gigawatts level overnight. So we can refer to the Toyota when it made first the electric cars. It started little. It started many years ago. And only when we take steps one by one are we able to achieve big things. Well, in the past, not long ago, I was in a meeting, and a technical director of a Toyota told me that their cost of a fuel cell is per kilowatt is 300 RMB per kilowatt, while ours is 3,000. So there is a huge gap. Therefore, we totally need to achieve the economy of scale. We need to ensure high quality while reducing the cost. Then again, it comes to the application in the passenger vehicle. Now we only use it in heavy duty trucks, but there's only that many commercial cars, only 4,000 commercial car operation carriers. So if each company only gives you 1 to 2 vehicles as the fuel cell as fuel cell pilot, then it's just not enough. I started my career as the exhaust scientist. The rule of thumb is 10,000 passenger vehicles. So we have to reach at least 10,000 vehicles application. Are we able to make a technology work? If we are not able to apply the technology on at least 10,000 vehicles or at least 1 million vehicles, then the technology will never survive. It's also the same with OEMs. The OEMs, if they are not able to sell more than 1 million cars, they will die. In China, in the past few years, many EV car companies emerged, but I would say many of them will die because they are not able to achieve the economy of scale. And another thing I think we have ignored is there's many logistic cars which take deliveries. This is also a big market. Every day, about 4 to 5 such delivery cars will be used in a single neighborhood. This is another big market, the logistic. For example, Prague is successful simply because it focused on the forklift market. So the route. So one misunderstanding: we should not only associate hydrogen power with the transportation. And another thing is we need to expand the use of hydrogen to the passenger vehicle. And the third thing is I would say that the hydrogen will not only be used in the water electrolysis. In the past 130 years, hydrogen, only less than 1% of the hydrogen is made out of the renewable energies. Most of the hydrogen is made out of fossil fuels. So if the natural gas combined with the water to produce hydrogen, then the emission will be reduced by 70% or close to 80%, and that can solve a lot of problem. Where does the natural gas come from? Well, we have the coal mine, right? If we dig deep into the coal mine, there will be a lot of natural gas.
That will be enough to meet our needs, because in China, we do not lack natural gas. It's just that we don't have effective ways of using natural gas. If we make best of the natural gas, we can use natural gas to produce hydrogen to generate power. How about carbon? We recycle the carbons, and the recycled carbons, dioxides, we cannot bury them underground. Then what can we do? We use them for water electrolysis. We, instead of electrolysis of water, we do electrolysis of carbon. And then after the electrolysis, we turn them into methanol and ethanol. That will be much easier than hydrogen. We don't need to produce hydrogen with water electrolysis. It's very much complicated. We can simply do direct synthesis of methanol and ethanol. So that's myth number two, that hydrogen does not come from natural gas. So there are various pathways for us to produce hydrogen instead of only one way. The third myth regards the hydrogen refueling station. Hydrogen refueling station. So why do we need such hydrogen refueling station? Is it because we need a gas station? Actually, we don't need such gas refueling station in the future. You can simply replace the hydrogen tank, because if you bottle hydrogen, it will be much safer compared with doing hydrogen refueling at any hydrogen refueling station by transporting hydrogen to the station with pipes or other types of means. I think the replacing the hydrogen tank will be much easier With that, if we do hydrogen refueling station, the investment is at tens of millions of levels, and the key technologies are controlled by foreigners. If we make breakthroughs on all three fronts, China's hydrogen will see leapfrog development. You may not agree with me because we already see new energy vehicle where you get replacement of your tank. And now you're talking about hydrogen to replacement of the hydrogen tank. I'm seeing the market. If the technology is there, however, it's not market ready, then the technology cannot be commercialized. That's my last sentence. So I want to emphasize that before developing a new technology, you need to have a valuable and workable business model for us. Actually, CIMC, we have a subsidiary already doing pilot program on the like replacing hydrogen tank. So regarding all the myths, it is understandable that you have mistakes in new areas. It's understandable, but our mindset sticks with the more difficult pathway, then you will have more setbacks. So I think maybe you can try doing some experiments in all of the areas that Mr. Chai just mentioned. Despite the three waves of hydrogen developments, you are mostly impressed by the coming into market of fuel cell vehicles. And actually, passenger vehicle is where real breakthroughs occurred in all three waves. And currently, we're seeing extension of applications into chemicals industry and into hydrogen industry. Professor Wu, Mr. Wu, you are from the smelting field, and we don't have any speaker talking about smelting, and you happen to be an expert. Maybe you can walk us through your company's practice and experiments on the smelting side. Our company was founded about 3 years ago under Baowu Group. We focus on clean energy as a subsidiary in Baowu, focusing on wind, hydrogen, and solar. So our focus is to provide to Baowu and steel mills clean energy supplies in the future. I think green hydrogen will play a very important role. For example, in 2018, Baowu Group published its low carbon roadmap to our concerning hydrogen, including furnace as well as a smelter. For the furnace, there is a company called Bayi Steel in Xinjiang working on it, and another pathway also uses hydrogen as a reduction agent and feedstock. I think in the smelting industry, compared with the transportation industry, demand for hydrogen is a megawatt, whereas in our field, demand should be a GW. So our estimate is that 1 ton of iron, 600 to 800 cubic meters of hydrogen. In other words, 0.1 ton of hydrogen needed for 1 ton of iron. What does that mean? Baowu is the world's largest steel mill group, and the goal is 200 million tons. China in total has 1 billion tons. So if 10% to 20% goes to the hydrogen pathway, be it the furnace conversion pathway or the other pathway, demand from the smelting side will be much bigger compared with transportation industry. However, in terms of feasibility, actually in the smelting industry, there is the issue of mismatch. Anglo American and Baowu happen to be in the mining industry, but I had this impression that Anglo American is like minerals of industry, whereas steel is bread for the industry. Bread comes in abundant amount, and it's enough to satisfy your eating needs. However, minerals, they do not come in huge amounts, but they work well. So currently, when talking about green hydrogen in eastern and western part of China, in terms of resources, the
Most of the steel mills are in the eastern part of China along the Yangtze River or along rivers, but in the western part of China has resources. So for steel mills in the eastern part, they lack access to green hydrogen resources. Another mismatch regarding time. So currently 1 billion tons of steel mill and Baowu produces 200 million tons, but we only have 20% of the total market share in China. But per capita wise, we still fall far short of that in advanced countries. But the national government requests the steel industry to reduce our production and to control our emissions. That's about mismatch of time. And there is another mismatch on the product side. When we talk about green hydrogen, we think that key technologies, electrode catalyst, as well as improvement of the conductance or density, we think that if we want to reach tens of thousands of cubic meter level, there's still a long way to go. I think if we can address the three mismatches, hydrogen may see exponential growth in the smelting and steel mill industry, and demand for hydrogen might be even bigger compared with transportation industry. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Wu.
Indeed, as you rightly pointed out, steel mill and the steel is a market very close to chemicals. And this is something that's really, we really need to look forward to. I have some more questions for you later on, but I want to shift the gear to ask the question to Frank Ni from Anglo America. Because generally, as a mining company, they tend to have very focused business. But I think, well, as I've observed Anglo America for a long time, before I started to do research in this field, I didn't pay attention to Anglo America. It was not until I came into contact and I became acquainted with Tony. I know that Anglo America is not only a supplier of raw materials, instead they're working on building an ecosystem. Maybe you can say something more about how Anglo America is working on ecosystem building. Many thanks. I'm really happy to have this chance to talk about green hydrogen economy. As you rightfully pointed out, Anglo America has a history of over 100 years. We are a world leader in mining. We are a mining giant. As early as 2012, we started our transformation and we started our marketing, we started BD ourselves. So currently speaking, we have abided by the vision of the group. In other words, we want to reshape the mining industry for the betterness of human life. And on top of that, I think you're all familiar with the smart mining project, which is actually very relevant to our pursuit of zero carbon or net zero emissions future. In other words, we want to achieve net zero by 2040 on the part of the operations on operations of the mining mountains. And hydrogen takes up 20% of the energy mix in the project because we need green hydrogen. And in our design, in our blueprint, hydrogen is like a bridge. It connects renewable resources or renewable energy on one hand, and it contributes to energy efficiency improvement and emissions reduction on the other hand. Why am I saying it? For us, I work at the PGM department, so hydrogen market represents an emerging market for us and also a supplier to us, because in the process of bringing down our emissions, in addition to gradually phasing out coal, electricity,
replacing it by green electricity powered by green hydrogen and solar. We are also working on changing the way we operate by switching to hydrogen power system. You may saw from our video, we have the 540 town system. This has already become a business. If you have noticed, I wonder if you noticed a company called First Node or First Mode. They focus on helping our group to build a more efficient power system. That's their focus business. So on the front of hydrogen, we have been working to promote the hydrogen economy, and we are an early mover as well as an active player on this front in the market. For us, we champion for policy initiatives. We also work to facilitate exchanges and communications and the alliance, the formation of alliance and associations in the industry. Another focus of us is to do technological incubation together with research institutes from zero to one, or from research results into commercially viable products. We have done a lot in all of these areas. You may notice today that in the backstage, we have, and also in the morning session, some of the projects that we signed to do things directly related to hydrogen economy in, to be more specific, three projects do things directly related to hydrogen economy. So hydrogen is very, at the very core of our business. But again, our, we have, nine more ecosystems. In other words, we're actively working on improving the 10 ecosystems. You are all from our downstream partners, customers, our customers' customers. So we try to learn from you how we can better provide service to you. Thank you. Many thanks to Frank. I joke with Tony this noon saying that interest is a good thing as it brings us together. So for us, our common interest is to achieve a lifestyle featuring low carbon or zero carbon in the process of energy transition or in the process of energy revolution. In addition to low carbon, another characteristic that stands out is that in the past, we relied very much upon resources, but now we're seeing the shift towards dominance by manufacturing sector. Anglo America is a supplier of resources, though we do see a detail that efforts are being made to bring down the use of PGM and the platinum. That's a fact. And Anglo America is working on this front as well. That's a significant change that we have observed. We have done in lab and in real world a lot of projects. At the end of the day, we need to achieve scaled production. As I mentioned that in the process of energy development, throughout the three waves of hydrogen development, including the fourth wave where we use hydrogen to address the intermittency and the fluctuation of renewable energy, we are at a critical juncture for the inclusion of renewable into the grid. So this challenge must be addressed.
Sitting on the stage are the leaders and the pioneers who can help us achieve the economy of scale in the hydrogen industry. So I want to hear from your ideas. So the production at scale, well, in PEM, the most important, most critical thing is the use of a precious metal. So as I said, the PEM is able to withstand high fluctuation. Now, the only less than 20% of the hydrogen is produced from renewable energy. If we are to increase the use of the renewable energy in the overall power grid, then it will cause a higher fluctuation. It will cause stress to the power grid as well. So we're definitely need the help of power storage, and PEM will develop will have a large potential and large momentum in this regard. And in the future, there will be large need of demand for PEM. We are moving towards this target, namely to make our PEM technology more suitable for meeting the high target for hydrogen electrolysis. And we also know that the precious metal is used at a pretty high level at the anode side, especially. And for the cathode, it needs iridium, which is even more expensive. Every 2 metric tons, every gigawatt of hydrogen would need 2 metric tons of iridium. And another thing is anode is in a highly corrosive and the high electric potential environment, so it will also affect this the structure of the anode. Therefore, we need a coating. Well, on the coating, we also use platinum and the iridium. Well, I would like to remind you that maybe you can approach from the industry side, because I see you are the you also co-founded a company yourself, right? Well, what we are doing right now is how to produce all these components at scale. For example, the stray pore layer. At the beginning, it was a lab product, but my company is thinking how to produce this at scale. So one side, on the one hand, we need to reduce the cost. On the other side, we need to improve the homogeneity of the layer. Only in this way are we able to push the production at scale for PEM. The other thing I want to talk about is the using PEM in water electrolysis. Well, in the US and in Siemens in Germany and in other companies in the Western world, they are already able to achieve the megawatt level electrolysis. So, in other words, PEM can totally work, and there is already technology solution. So the key is to synthesize the catalyst at a low cost. If we can synthesize at scale, maybe at tens or hundreds of metric tons, then we can make the product more appealing to the commercial world. Great. And we are running out of time, Dr. Chai. So I see that you have already signed a contract with the major clients. So maybe you have your own experience in production at scale. So maybe you can talk about it briefly. Well, we are basically a power plant. In China, if we use hydrogen to serve as the energy storage, we would need 200 million metric ton of hydrogen. Put that in perspective, if it is 5 kilowatt hour per cubic meter hydrogen, then it means we need 1 trillion kilowatt hour of power, which is even higher than all the power consumption last year in China. So we need to totally solve the problem of producing hydrogen at scale. Let's not focusing only on water electrolysis. There are many different ways we need to diversify the hydrogen generation approaches in terms of mass production. Well, on one side, we need to improve the scale and then reduce the cost. Actually, these two things go hand in hand. Well, thank you, Mr. Chai. And you're not only making pilot projects in the hydrogen fuel cells, but also you are looking at alternative ways to develop hydrogen. That's great. And let's see what are the latest developments in Mr. Wu's company. Well, the mass produced hydrogen for us means a few things. First of all, we need to improve the capacity. Well, we expanded our production capacity. By the end of this year, we are able to have a shop floor of over 300,000 square meters. And we can also improve the hydrogen production from 1 gigawatt to 3 gigawatt. And in terms of the technology, well, I can assure you that all the the bottlenecks have already been solved, like with standing fluctuation and start and stop of the system. We have solved these problems, but of course we need to improve that. We need to ensure that with the same quality anode and cathode, we keep improving the performance. Baowu mostly take construction and engineering projects, so maybe Mr. Wu from Baowu is more like a leader in this industry. So what you have done in hydrogen smelting? The first thing we're trying to do is to try to find the potential, discover the potential. Well, in 2020, we have invested in 60 hydrogen power cars and many hydrogen star charging station. And now the station, power station, is already one of the busiest hydrogen station in Shanghai. In other regards, we are also working on the hydrogen smelting and in a refinery. We hope that the water electrolysis can be of low cost so that it can totally support our smelting process. Then the third thing is we also hope that the supplier can solve the major technology issues of customers. Just now we have heard technical breakthroughs in PEM and in other other hydrogen generations, but you need to customize the solutions. For example, if this plant has the nuclear power or has some heat reaction, maybe you can use the solid solution. But if it is a large scale plant, then we probably should go back to the AWE. So one thing to expand on the use case and scenarios, and the second is to customize the solutions to the large scale companies. Okay, and we also hope that your application can be copied or can be rolled out to more cases. Well, Mr. Frank Ni, what is your thinking about this question, how to help with the mass production of hydrogen? The green hydrogen now is like the fuel cell in 2015 and 2016. So in other words, it's a bit early to talk about mass production. Now, what's crucial is technology innovation and proof of concept and proof of technology. We have visited some companies. The company said you need to provide us the statistics of a 1,000-hour operation. Well, I would say in some scenarios, we do not have such testing results. So we advocate that the companies working in this field work on your testing, work on your technology. And if you do have good technology, we are totally willing to support you financially and technology-wise. In the automobile and sectors, for example, we also participated in the Shell hydrogen charging station project. In China, we are working on the same similar projects as well. We are investing also in the pilot project of hydrogen fuel cells. So we would really love to see companies interested in this field to push the same cause forward. Okay, I totally understand. Let's close the loop of the value chain. And finally, I want to give every panelist the chance of speaking in one sentence. What would be your vision for 2050? We hope the green hydrogen can enjoy rapid development. Well, by 2025, I hope the passenger hydrogen vehicle can be around in the cities that people can see. Okay, I hope that with a better economy of green hydrogen, we can achieve a virtuous cycle of the value chain. Well, I would say that the future is bright, but the road is winding. And I believe by 2025, there will definitely be a turning point. Well, I would say by 2025, the fuel cell cost reduction can achieve the target we stipulated in the roadmap. The second thing is, I hope the hydrogen economy can truly become a low carbon economy, and it can truly become a pillar for the society to move towards carbon peak and carbon zero. Thank you very much. And I'd also hope that by 2025, the whole society can reach a consensus as we see on the stage right now. Thank you very much for all the panelists.